It is so exciting to have this event today, and the reason for that is because history matters. History really matters, and being new to this community myself, I've been asking myself, what is the history, especially of our Latino and Tejano community with respect to Washington County? So we have three speakers today who can talk about that in depth. So I want to introduce them to you. Jose Jaime. Jose, please, can we give him a hand? With all due respect, Vanji Sanchez. And Hector Hinojosa. And I will say this, generally in Latino culture, there's a great deal of respect that we pay to our elders, and I hope you don't mind us calling you that. But you have a lot of life experience.
Viejitos,
okay. But it is really important that in our culture that we respect what they have to say. And I know for the record, the things that you say today will be very helpful in documenting history from your perspective. And this history isn't only important to the Latino community, but to the community in general here in Washington County. So we'd like to start by asking you three quick questions, okay? And I suppose we'll start with Jose here, but where is your family originally from? And why did your family choose to come to Washington County? And what was it like in the years that you started, when your family moved here? What was Washington County like? And I'm gonna ask our other panelists also to respond to those questions. So we'll start with Jose.
My family is from Mazatepec, which is in the state of Morelos. You probably have heard of Cuernavaca, the city of eternal springtime. I was the 10th of 10 children, and my family was a farm worker family, working really hard, barely making ends meet. Being the youngest of 10, I asked my dad, I don't want to be a farm worker. So he says, what do you want to be? I said, anything, but you guys work too hard and don't earn much. He says, you have to get a good education. And that stuck in my mind to the point of, at the tender age of 12, I was recruited by the Catholic seminary to join the seminary, where I lived 4 years of high school, living like in a military place. After the 4 years, I earned a scholarship to come to the States. There was another seminary in New Mexico. And after 3 years of college, they said, you have to move to Oregon, to Mount Angel. You had to graduate the same year and learn English the same year. So a task that I thankfully achieved without going crazy, as one of my other classmates, he had to return to Mexico because he wanted to learn English too fast and keep up with all the subjects. Anyway, I got my bachelor's and I kept going since then to Cuernavaca and to Oregon, to Cuernavaca and to Oregon, off and on. In that time, I was able to start working with the Hispanic community in Marion County and later on in Washington County. So my family didn't move here. I moved here. And I moved to Oregon to start my own family. And we've been here since 86, but I've known Washington County and Marion County since 1961. In 1966, I spent a whole summer working for the Valley Migrant League, which was a chain of state agencies helping the Hispanic communities in all the different counties. And working for the Valley Migrant League at that time gave me the sense that teaching Christian doctrine that I was teaching in Marion County goes better when it's also joined by working as a social worker. And for me, that's when I woke up to the needs of the Hispanic community in Marion County and Washington County. And especially after I saw the abhorrent conditions of the migrant camps in North Plains and all the area around Hillsborough, that was really a shocker. That was the second shocker. The first shocker was when I came from Mexico into the States, when I got off Chihuahuenses transports to the transport with a big dog. What's the name of? Greyhound. I had to walk, and I was hungry, and I saw a restaurant, and the sign said, no blacks, no dogs, no Mexicans. I said, I'm coming to the land of the free and the brave. So my life has been not of shock, but of conviction to work for the engagement and the improvement of the Hispanic community, especially since then.
Gracias, Jose. Okay, well, so Vanjie, can you elaborate on our questions, please?
Okay, my family came here to the United States 92 years ago from Zacatecas and from Guadalajara, Jalisco. I have Spanish and Aztec blood, which makes me Mixteca, Jose was telling me.
Mestiza.
Mestiza, there
a
you go.
A real mestiza.
Yeah, a mestiza. My grandparents were struggling, and an uncle of my mom's went to visit them and noticed that they were practically starving in their little town. So he decided to recruit them to come to the United States and do sharecropping, you know, where the farm owner would give them half of whatever and crop they were working on. And even the poultry and beef and everything was shared. My mom says that was such a blessing to them because they would not have survived, you know, and she really empathizes right now with the migrants that are coming from the other countries. She says, nobody knows what it's like. You know, I know that people hate us for coming over here, but nobody knows what it's like to see your family struggling so hard. She says, so it just breaks my heart to see what's happening at the border right now. These people don't want to be here. She says, we didn't want to leave our little town, but we couldn't survive there. Yeah. I was one of 12 kids, six boys and six girls. I am number five. Yeah. And I stayed here in the state of Oregon as a single parent. I left and came back as a single parent, and I loved it here, you know. And I came with my parents. I kind of followed them because the propaganda that the rancheros take to Texas about what a beautiful cabin you're going to have here, you know, with laundry, with washing machines and bathrooms and scenery and everything, was not what we found when we got here. You know, this is, I'll show you a picture. This is what we found. It's a little run down now. That's what we came to find. You know, that was the luxury place they had for us to work. And what we were gonna work was not what they explained to us that we were, the kind of work that we would be doing. So it was a real shocker to come to that. But we kind of fell into the migrant stream and went to California, Colorado, you name it, you know, in order to survive. We we kind of came back to Oregon in 67, stayed a couple of years, and then went back to California. And then I decided, no, I want to come back with my kids. You know, this is where I want them to grow up. And that's how I landed here in Oregon. And to be honest, I think that was a large part of their success. They are very successful. We have really done well. Even notice the picture, it says Vinny something, I can't always remember. But it says, I came, I saw, and I conquered, and I think we did. Because from there to being business owners, you know, one of them retired at 53 because he was so successful. The other one will retire at 63, you know, they all are business owners. You know, and it's like, we have really done well, you know. We have really succeeded in our lives, so, yeah. And when we came here, Washington County was not as diverse. We were kind of scared to go out there. There was racial profiling. You know, every chance we got to be down that North Plains Road, we would get stopped, you know, and there were not as many Hispanics. We were not very welcome here. I have a child that's been traumatized since he was very little working in the fields because when we came out of the fields and we went to the store to buy, you know, something to eat, and the kids went to get their candy, and one of the cashiers looked at him when he was going to give her the money, and she says, "Put it down there, you dirty little Mexican." And he will not, to this day, go to a grocery store and shop for that reason. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so, and I was telling Dr. Villa that one of the things that I wish would really happen is that we would write our own story, that people would ask us about our own story, and that we would write it, because it seems like everybody else writes our story but us. We need to. But I also understand that we are struggling all the time to get ahead. We have, you know, to support our families and everything, and we don't have time to do that. So, you know, any of you that wants to take that on, I would love for that to start happening now. We need to document our history, you know, and let people know what it was really like, because people don't know what we have struggled with. Yeah, so that's my story.
Uh-huh. And something that we have agreed, the two of us, is the fact that our parents emphasized education, and we emphasized education in our kids.
To our kids, yes, very much so. Out of the four, three went to college. School wasn't for one of them. No, 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 it wasn't for him. So, yeah, so they've done very well. And these two know my kids very well. Yeah, so thank you.
Thank you, Vanjie. Gracias. Okay, next we have Hector.
I was born in Matamoros, Tamaulipas, up in the north, right on the tip of Texas. Right on the Gulf. So there's the tip of Texas, and we migrated in 1952 into Harlingen, Texas. And that's the next picture, if you'll turn to it. That's me in Mom's lap. That was our immigration visa for the family. This is in 1952. It took 2 years to wait on the list to get your interview for this process. That's in 52. Today, immigration is processing 1997 applications, 22 years waiting to get your appointment. Talk about a broken system. They're not going to wait, and that's why they're coming. They're coming because of socioeconomics. That shows the path that we migrated back and forth for about 2 or 3 years. And back in the 60s and 70s, the farm worker mainstream map, and I looked for it, I couldn't find it. It looks like an elk's antlers. Everybody came out of Texas and then spread out through the United States like this, back and forth. For years, these were the trends. For generations, these were the trends of migrant seasonal farm workers. That just happened to be ours, all the way up to Washington and back. Part of the exhibit and part of our panel is how we contributed as farm workers to the agribusiness, I guess. And several things come to mind. First one is that we harvested, irrigated, pruned, weeded. Oh, the little short hole is now illegal, thank goodness. And as I try to follow the map, we start with cotton in Texas. We did oranges, grapefruits, figs, plums, cherries, strawberries, blackberries, walnuts, holly, filberts, potatoes, beets, and then back. And we did that 2 or 3 years. That's a lot of food of putting on people's plate. And we weren't the only families, obviously, doing that. So the farm workers that live this horrible life in these little 10 by 14 by 14 shacks and have a horrible socioeconomic life, very poor, contribute to the, not just the economy, but the nutrition, quite frankly, of survival in this country. So I do take a lot of pride in the contributions that we made. That's me again with my brother. 1961 is when we decided not to go back anymore and we settled here. That's just right outside of town at the Pat Unger's camp out in Farmington. This, after the Tualatin Valley crops are over, then we jump over the mountain into Newburgh and down on that part of the Willamette Valley. And in this case, you can see the cucumbers that I'm the little guy with a hat. And the other gentleman is actually my dad's cousin who migrated and traveled with us. The other two are my brothers. And you get paid by the 5-gallon bucket that you see there at the bottom. So with those size of cucumbers, man, we could make money because you get paid piece rate. Mm-hmm. And so we were able to fill them up pretty quick. So we were bragging about that day, about the great crop, the great harvesting day we had. And then I dropped out of high school and left and went into Job Corps. And in Job Corps, I became a leader. I actually developed the first leadership training program that still exists today with the U.S. Department of Labor and Job Corps. And I was one of nine delegates from the state of Oregon that was sent by Governor Tom McCall to President Nixon's conference on youth in 1971. Three of us from the same school were elected out of the whole nine in the whole state. I mean, we were shakers and movers as young people. There were 1,000 leaders in the United States that were elected, appointed to go. And I happened to be blessed to be one of them. One of the things that we did, most of us is Vanjie and I probably were two of maybe a dozen families. All of us were Tejanos, as I was showing it, came up, migrated, and landed here. So we had a lot of things in common. Language, which is kind of like Spanglish, I guess. It is not the Spanish that Jose Jaime speaks or people from South America. It's very different Spanish. Spices, food, language, music. We dance around the hall like this. And other Latinos look at it like, what are you doing? Well, you're showing off your young lady. That's what you're doing. And you dance around the salon like this. So even the way we dance is different. Everything is very different. It is a culture of its own, an enclave within an enclave. One of the first organizations that we built here to help support our infrastructure was El Club de los Amigos. The Club de los Amigos was designed and made for like a credit union where you could borrow funds for emergencies and pay back at low interest to the organization. The money was pooled together through fundraising, selling tacos and enchiladas at one at a time. The other organization Jose Jaime alluded to was Valley Migrant League. This is in 1967, and the first lady, Mrs. Lopez, I think is Tina's mom. And then the next one is my mother, and they're in ESL classes, learning English at their age, and they were so proud that they finally are, you know, fired up and going back to school, because in Mexico, the educational system is free education to the sixth grade, and they have to pay for it afterwards. So it's not unusual to find people who come from Mexico on the poor side of town anyway. You're either filthy rich or filthy poor, one of the two. There's no middle class like we have here. And so my mom had a sixth grade education and my dad had a third grade education. Couldn't read or write English and yet managed to follow a map to get us all the way over here and back several times. I still don't get it. They're amazing people, my heroes. As a young man, like Jose Jaime, I felt a need for fighting for social justice. We did have racial issues, being yelled at from, you know, strangers going down, just walking down the sidewalk and being yelled, you know, you speck, go back where you came from. I mean, just awful things. So I became a Brown Beret, which is the equivalent of a Black Panther, Chicano powers. I didn't carry a gun, although I thought about it. And that's when I decided to change my life and get married. And that was a different kind of fight. But at any rate, this one was a Brown Beret. My mentor was from Linfield University, who was a Brown Beret himself. And we stood up for social justice. When we did demonstrations, we were the ones that stood up with our hands, you know, showing nonviolence, of course, between the crowd, which were the resistance, and the people that were marching in the back. We had to do that because police, quite frankly, didn't come to protect us and to do that. So we did our own. This is one of the neat organizations nobody talks about that still exists today. You know, we do get a little play sometimes too. This is the Chicanos of Oregon Golfers Association, home of the Chile Jalapeño Open. It is in its 44th year, fundraising and scholarship monies that go out every year to students, and right now I think our host is maybe Western University, I think, who's hosting it. Sonny Montes, who was the director of Valley Migrant League and one of my mentors, is still actively involved with the leadership and the scholarship part of it, as well as a good sand duff golfer. Jose Jaime and I did a visit of the Virginia Garcia Memorial Health Clinic a couple of months ago, and we found this young lady sitting on the logo. And we thought, boy, that just looked like little Virginia Garcia. I was blessed to be the summer school principal where Virginia Garcia was going to school and had to send her home because of the high fever that she had and her medical condition Obviously couldn't have her around the other children. And 2 days later, she passed away. So it helped to today, the promotores of Virginia Garcia are actually doing triage when they run into situations like this, making determination whether they should go to ER right away, urgent care, or just wait to see the doctor, or let's go get the prescription filled now, and here's the instructions on how to take that medication. Those pieces were missing when the little girl died. Very simple triage stuff in the proper language, and could have saved that little girl's life. As far as the community health, it was already on the radar. Cesar Chavez, the farm worker movement, put it on the radar, and Robert Kennedy was able to find the funds to fund community health centers. Community health center funds are very different than anybody else because it requires that 51% of the board members, the policymakers, be patient user category. And so they are literally ran by the patients. And that's what the difference between a community health center and something like Quality Community, where I'm on, also on the board. Colegio Cesar Chavez and Mount Angel, where Jose Jaime went to college, we started a college without walls curriculum. So today, I guess it's called you know, through the internet, you can get your degree and all that good stuff. We did that back in the 70s, where you could get your education and literally, in fact, Vanjie earned her degree from Colegio Cesar Chavez. So that was a great institution for us. Unfortunately, it didn't last.
Thank you, Hector. Gracias. Okay. So I have a question, and I'll ask Jose to respond, and of course, Vanjie and Hector. But what did you do to create pathways for new incoming migrants and other Latinos, Tejanos, in Washington County? And what should we be doing now to sustain those pathways?
What I did personally was not much, in the sense that I was actually thrown into the river and say, go swim. I got my education at Mount Angel. I was able to make friends with Hispanic families in Washington County. And they had founded an organization called Centro Cultural. That was the families of the time when Hector's parents were settling in Washington County. They said, we need to organize ourselves and help each other. And that was really the main source of a movement that is still going on very strongly. The families organized themselves into a nonprofit organization. So it is called Centro Cultural de Washington County, both English and Spanish, Centro Cultural de Washington County. And they formed themselves, and after 2 or 3 years of existence, they started running into the problems of our Hispanic families. We have certain commotion to change. And they decided, as a board, to let the executive director at the time, who did a wonderful job both in being the executive director, the first executive director of Centro Cultural, and also the starter of the Virginia Garcia Clinic. His name is Leonel Lucero, and his wife, Josefina, was being in charge of the Virginia Garcia Clinic, the reception area. So Leonel did a very good job in starting, but the board came to the point of saying, it's time for you to go, and they were left without an executive director. I was in Mexico, and I was invited. A family from here went to Cuernavaca and said, we need you. And by that time, I had been working with Father Frank Canuso and the previous pastor that was at St. Alexander, Father Beezer. And we started working informing the Hispanic ministry for the Archdiocese of Portland, and we formed 7 different missions, including St. Alexander's in Cornelius. So I was invited to come to assist, and that's how the families got to know me better. When Leonel was asked to leave the Centro, then the family said, we need your help. And I said, how can I help? I says, you can be the next executive director of Centro Cultural, but we don't have any way to pay. So I said, okay, I'll go, just let me know how I can help. So they contacted Community Action at that time, and the executive director of Community Action at that time was Gordy Molitor. And he said, well, what we will do is we will pay Jose to be the executive director, but he will be working under Community Action. So Community Action actually was the one that saved Centro Cultural through me by re-establishing Centro Cultural again. So you have to remember that our board of directors had a minimum, maybe not minimum, but an average education of maybe 3 or 4 years of grade school. So they were with pencils and guns, ruling
literally,
the board.
Literally packing. Mm-hmm.
So when I came on board, I said, we need younger blood to start working as board members. And then it's when Vanjie was asked to be on the board, and Adelia Hernandez was
on
the board.
And we're the same age, okay, younger.
So for me, working for the Hispanic community was working to make sure that the mission of Centro Cultural was somehow realized, put into practice by the families themselves who organized themselves. Mm-hmm. And it was at that time that we were able to get almost $1 million to build the first Centro Cultural building. Mm-hmm. And because of the community not really being happy that Centro Cultural was having this money that was granted to the city of to the city of Cornelius by the block grant, and they didn't want the money afterwards when they learned that administrative services were not going to be paid by them in the future. They said, we don't want the money. We said, the need has been proven. We want the money and we will administer it. And that's how we got the first building. Well, from almost $1 million, we lasted about a year of infighting to finally get in the money. And we got the equivalent of, I think it was 825,000. So the 3,000 square feet that we were going to build became much less. And so I said, well, I already secured the new building, I already secured the funding for the new building, I already secured the funding for 3 people through United Way. I am ready to go back. So I worked and I told Gordy, time for me to leave. By the way, his dad was helping Centro Cultural books to be put in order because that was not their specialty. So, and that's what caused a lot of the problems. So his dad, he's how old, 96?
He was 96.
Uh-huh. Was working really hard from Minnesota, helping us in here. And I really appreciated that Community Action came and really helped Centro Cultural to not stay stagnant or not to lose its life. So since then, Centro Cultural has moved into forming a lot of other organizations, including not only the ones that they already had, like Los Amigos, but also Petra Perez Senior Center, the Virginia Garcia Clinic, Adelante Mujeres, and they still continue moving on. So that was my participation, and I think that's where I was able to say I put my little grain of salt into the pot to give a taste.
Okay, gracias, José. All right. Okay, Vanji.
Okay. Well, excuse me, when we first settled, that I said we settled in Tigard, Oregon, I took cosmetology and just like, oh, this does not feel right to me. You know, something is missing. So when we came back the second time around, I started working for Migrant Education with Jose Garcia, which we, most of us know. And one of his requirements when we started working with him was that we get a college education if possible, and he would pay for it. And I will forever be grateful to that man for doing that. And that's where my love started growing for getting involved more with Colegio Cesar Chavez. I was in the fields when Cesar Chavez was fighting. Everybody was fighting, and we marched. We got involved with everything. It was a very sad time for, because we saw a lot of brutality and everything, you know. But anyway, when Jose started doing that, that was kind of the end of my marriage because I was getting too smart and getting a little bit too ahead. But, you know, I kept on going anyway. And one of the things that I loved to do was getting involved with the board when Jose asked me to be on the board. And I think that's where I really felt like, boy, I'm really a part of this community. I worked for the Virginia Garcia Clinic for 13 years, was one of the first receptionists there. And that's when we were in the little garage. And I could hear all the diagnoses. I could hear everything that was going on because it was a garage. And we just
HIPAA.
Yeah.
And HIPAA was
no HIPAA, no, no. And sometimes you had to laugh and sometimes you got sad because of all the things that you were hearing. But anyway. You know, I got involved with them. I got involved with Leonel Lucero, who was a real fighter. And sometimes I don't think he gets enough credit for what he did for the community. Because, yes, he did carry a gun and, you know, fought for the clinic, fought for Centro, fought for everything. And I was telling the guys, one of the funny things I remember being on the board is that Ralph Brown, who used to be mayor of Cornelius, we were sitting there and we were on the board and everybody else had guns and it got pretty violent, you know, because they threatened to shoot us and everything. And Ralph, you know, is younger than I am, so he runs over to me and he says, Vanji, he says, they've got guns. And I said, yeah, honey. I said, I think you and I are the only two that are not packing. And he freaked out, you know, because it got pretty bad. And that's when we were fighting for the clinic to become its own entity, you know, because Woodburn wanted to keep everything. So some of the things that I think that I've done for the community is, and they might not be significant to some people, but I was one of the first women to organize and manage a Hispanic soccer team. And that opened the door for, oh my God, millions of soccer teams now here in this area. Because it gave the guys the confidence to go and they would ask me for help to fill in the forms and everything. In fact, I had the flu when they came and asked me to call the Willamette Valley Soccer League to get them enrolled. And I said, okay, we can do this. And they said, well, you know what, the registration is over. And I begged the guy to please let us in. And they became one of the first teams to carry the traveling trophy for maybe 5 or 6 years, if not more. I lost track of them after I quit, yeah. I have taught ESL with Valley Migrant League to the adults, and also taught ESL to the kids at Cornelius Grade School. I fought for the clinic. I mean, I really wanted it to stay here because it was also a part of my having health insurance for my children. It was a survival thing for me. And I tell my kids, I always apologize to them for the time that I lost with them, because you do have to dedicate time when you're fighting for a cause. And they say, Mom, you know, at least this happened and that happened, and you know, and we're proud of you, and I'm so glad you did it, you know, because I think you were the only woman that was really in the community fighting. I call these two the politicos, because they know all the politics. I know the grassroots of the community, you know. That's where I came from, being a single mom and fighting for everything, yeah. And I try to be a role model to a lot of kids. I recently called one of the counseling agencies and one of the kids recognized my name and he says, you know, I've never talked to you, but I hear your name. And I went to one conference and I'm so impressed with the work that you do with the Hispanic community because you're always in there fighting. You're always there for whoever, you know, and that's, I think, what it's all about. I was telling Jose and Hector one day, you know, I love that there's so many young kids that are getting all these certificates or whatever, all these accolades for whatever they do. I said, but I want them to come back to the community. I want them to turn back and help, because when we were fighting, we didn't get all those kudos and whatever. We were about community, and we didn't care about them. It mattered that our community survived. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Venci. Gracias. Okay, Hector, do you have more slides for us?
Well, yeah. I'm going to really cut it short because I went over on the last one. But yeah. The things that Jose and Venci left out a whole lot of contributions and things that they do and have been. One of the things that I have to mention on Vanji's side, because she, there was nobody else in the community doing this. She ended up getting a job and retired from the State Department for Children's Services. Our families, some of the kids were being taken away from the families, or juvenile delinquency, all the things that happen would end up in foster care. No bilingual, bicultural, no tortillas, no arroz, no frijoles, nothing. And they were, I mean, you talk about cultural clash and sink or swim emotionally, psychologically. Vanji managed to get a job, and she carried all by herself, I hate to say that weight for that whole area of advocacy for Latinos in the navigating the system, because once you're in there, you can't get out. Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's awful. She not only went in and became a case manager, but became a trainer to train parents and recruit foster parents that were bilingual, bicultural. She carried huge weight on her shoulders. So thank you for that, because nobody else did it. And there's a lot of people trying to mimic that now still, but they're actually fruits, seeds that she planted from other people that are currently at the table. But that's still an area we need to pay attention to.
I think I have to mention something. When I first went to the state job, Talitha Benjamin was my boss, and she says, well, you know where I want you? I want you in investigations. And I said, investigations? What does that mean? You know, investigating child abuse. And so she threw me in there, and I was so angry with her, because that's the hardest job you can do. You work with detectives, court systems that you're not familiar with, and you have to fight for those kids. But I truly thank her, because I think that after that, I felt like I could rule the world. I learned so much. Yeah, so anyway, I just...
And it'll with Jose Jaime. There were so many other areas that he was involved with besides... the ones that he mentioned. One of them, similar to Vanji's, was community corrections. She actually got involved and retired from Washington County Corrections Division as a supervisor. And being able, again, our community's going through jail and going through this whole process of trying to navigate their way through, and there was somebody that could help at the other end. He actually had his master's not just in divinity as a priest, but he also had his master's in social work. And so he was able to do that counseling for our Latino people that are get caught up in the corrections.
And one of the hardest things, too, is that when we do that with a community that you live in, you know, you're afraid that if you know someone that's coming into the system, that they're going to be so embarrassed and hate you for being there and knowing all about their lives. It's not true. A lot of them were actually very grateful that they could communicate, because even if they're Tejanos, you know, that speak English and they're bilingual or whatever, and they will be so grateful that there's a familiar face and you can say, I'm here to work with you. And they really appreciate that, yeah.
Absolutely. That holds true today in education and schools and so on. So my part in the stuff that Jose was talking about, Centro Cultural Virginia Garcia, Valley Migrant League, all of those, this is LULAC. If you don't know who they are, the League of United Latin American Citizens, one of the oldest social civil rights organizations in the United States, 90 years old, taking on issues like Jose Jaime was talking about back in the 40s and 50s, knocking down walls, and if you couldn't get a drink out of a fountain in the city hall, then kicked it over. And they got to the point where they were calling an emergency. A state of emergency because of the resistance that they were putting to this whole anti-discrimination bigotry that was going on. The founders of LULAC were World War II veterans. And they came and said, we fought for the land, and to be treated this way is not acceptable. And they formed LULAC, 90 years old. They have six tenants that were alive back when everything that we were just talking about and are alive today. And I like to think that that is part of the national agenda for Latinos nationally. And it's sad that for 90 years we're still in the same place. That's a sad part about it. The best part is that we're still fighting to make a difference. Socioeconomic condition, development for Latinos. As a group, we're still way under disparities from the national average in terms of income. Obtained an education. 41% of Latinos in the state of Oregon have a high school diploma or less. 12% have a bachelor's degree. That's just not sustainable. In 2019, political influence. We need allies. We need allies like you. We need allies in the elected officials to help fight, to help open doors for us. Let us in and we can compete, but we're still being left out of the process. People like, Dr. Villa here at PCC is like, we got high hopes for him. Poor guy, if he only knew the hopes we have for him, he'd turn around and go back home. Because we need him. We need his allies. We need his position. We need his support. Housing, health, and social justice. Those are still on my agenda. They were Mom and Dad's agenda. You both knew Mom and Dad. I mean, what y'all were talking about. I have brothers that still won't come to these events because they resent the amount of time that it took Mom and Dad fighting in the community. Being part, they were, the board members were at Centro Cultural every single day. Every day they were there. Board members don't do that today. And they show up with their little laptops and their notebooks, and they're great, where back then they carried and said, I call for the question on the, no Robert's Rules of Order. It was, and part
no
of
no time limit.
With no time limits, 2-3 o'clock in the morning board meetings was not at all unusual. But one of the things that was happening that really didn't get explained is that Woodburn was trying to start their Centro Cultural. We were trying to start our Centro Cultural. We were fighting for the same funds. Somebody thought, quit doing that. Let's just unite. No, we're not going to unite. Well, who's going to take charge? At the same time, Virginia Garcia gets started, and so does Woodburn, Salud de la Familia, gets started. And they're fighting for the same funds for health, community health care as well. So my role was actually to serve on both boards, to try to keep, and it helped a little bit. Nobody got shot. I almost bought a gun, like I said, and decided, this is getting way too much. So I decided not to do that, but continued my advocacy. Jose Jaime and I have been involved with Oregon State University for served the last three presidents on the Board of Visitors. This happens to be one of the first ones that we worked with Dr. Reeser. May he rest in peace. He's now passed on. You can see how young I was then, didn't have gray hair. But Jose Jaime and I have been, today are still on the Board of Visitors for the Metro Oregon State University Extension Service, Clackamas, Washington, and Multnomah County. Continue to stay actively involved. They've agreed to come into our community and participate with us. As quite frankly, the only institution who's embraced what we're up to and the agendas you're hearing about today. I'm also part of an organization called Defensa de la Dignidad, and it's similar to El Club de los Amigos. It's a local group who raise funds for immigration, as you can imagine, at the top of our list right now, for filing fees and attorney's fees. The system, once you fall into that system, is so different than regular tort type legal process that the rest of us are entitled to. If you can't afford an attorney, one will be afforded for you. Not here. 10% for bonds, not here. You pay the full amount, $10,000, whatever that bond is. So we've decided to partner together. We have about 30 members, if any of you are interested in participating. And we literally use those funds for legal defense. We march around the courthouse every Monday. Jose Jaime and I are there faithfully, along with some of our allies. 9 o'clock to 10 o'clock every Monday morning, except holidays. You're all invited. We're trying to show resistance to get ICE out of the courthouse. They're still in there. They're still arresting people. And obviously, that's heart-wrenching for us.
Okay, Hector, I do have another question for, So the question is, what have you observed between now and 50 years ago with respect to migrant workers' working and living conditions?
Number one, before we had agri, mm-hmm. fields all over. Mm-hmm. Now we have pavement, black tar, big factories. Nevertheless, we have our Hispanic family who used to work in the fields, still now getting full-time employment at vineyards, at nurseries, and a lot of other industries that provide a better living wage for their families. So in a way, something good brings something better. Something bad becomes something good. As I said, 40 years ago, there was a lot of agri, not much culture. Because most of our families were employed and working two or three jobs to make ends meet. Nowadays, now not only the husband, but the wife and maybe some of the older children are working. So they are making ends meet, probably more comfortable than when only they were working out in the fields as migrant workers. Education, we are on the same boat as 40 years ago. More than 50% of our Hispanic population does not graduate from high school. 40 years ago and today, that's a no-no. We have not been able to impact the system. I don't know if it's the education system that is at fault or if it's us, the community, who are at fault, but we have not made any progress. Health. We can maybe compare with the Virginia Garcia starting 43 years ago out of a three-car garage with the Virginia Garcia now having 19 clinics up to the top, especially the Virginia Garcia clinic here in Beaverton. Oh my goodness, where Hector took the picture. Are we really taking care of the poor patients at the Virginia Garcia clinic? That will be a question that you will have later on for the Virginia Garcia to respond, the staff. But I still think that the need for the poor that don't have health insurance are not getting it. Same as 40 years ago. Housing. I'm gonna put the mayor here to blush because they are building housing that is supposed to be affordable housing with houses that are costing $400,000 up to $1 million. So are we gonna be able to afford it? Not our families, okay? Is there any other efforts to do housing for the people in need? Not much. Are we on the same situation 40 years ago and today? Not by far. So those are the main fields. Casa, vestido y sustento, you know. Room and board, health, and a way to dress up. I can do it. I'm retired. But a lot of our people are still trying to make ends meet. So 40 years, more than 40 years, have created a community of maybe 13,000 during the summer. Throughout the year, maybe 2,000, 3,000 in Washington County to over 26,000 now permanent. Is it 26,000 here in Hillsborough or Washington County? Wow. Just Hillsborough. So our community is growing by leaps and bounds. We are doing well in promoting businesses. Out of every five businesses that start in Hillsborough, three are Hispanic businesses. we are doing well in beginning to make sure that the young generation is involved in the political arena. We are still very, 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 almost like 40 years ago. And I think if all of us become allies, like Hector was saying, I think we can help our youth, our Hispanic youth, become engaged into the political arena.
Okay, gracias. Banji.
Well, he basically said it all, you know, and yeah, he did, because that's exactly what I think. You might have more with your little slides, but but it's really, you know, I go back with a food bank and I volunteer, you know, when we distribute food and everything, and it just saddens me that those same conditions are still there. Nothing has changed. I'm not going to sugarcoat it. It's awful when we go there. And it's a hard thing even to distribute the food because people are, you know, there's a status thing there. You know, people that have come every year are the ones that go first and then, you know, so I've developed something that kind of helped out just so that that doesn't happen. But I don't see that many changes in the camps. I think that, you know, the sanitary conditions, everything is still the same. And, you know, I went with my mom up to North Plains the other day just because I wanted to reminisce before I moved to Spokane, Washington, because she's 97 years old and I'm leaving her behind. But it was like, wow, you know, there's like weed all over, grass fields, the camps are gone. And that's when I took a picture of one of the cabins that's there. And, you know, the families that first came here were the Tejanos, like Hector said. And then the Mexicanos, single Mexicanos started coming. And with the amnesty, they brought in all their families. So that's why our population has grown, I think, so much, because with the amnesty, you know, a lot of people got legalized. But just to see that they're still hoping for a better life, like some of the people that we've known. I worked for the community, for the clinic, I said, like for many years. And, you know, they're all fighting for that better life. And what's really cute sometimes is how, you know, when Jose was saying, I wonder if the migrants are really getting the medical care that they should be getting from the clinic. I still get calls, mind you, or if I meet up with someone at the store, my kids say, oh God, don't go to the store with this woman. She knows everybody. And they stop her and talk to her, you know, when we're shopping. And they say, Señora Sanchez, you know, if we don't have insurance, they're not willing to, you know, they're kind of hard on us about getting medical care. And it breaks my heart. I wish I could go over there, you know, and just tell them, why did this clinic get started? Because of a child that didn't get the proper medical care. That's where our corazones, our hearts should be. And that's what makes me the saddest about what's happening at the clinic. Mm-hmm. I used to work for billing in the clinic. This is really interesting. And they, when the Mexican, any family came to pay, especially I think the Mexican people, and they would say, Señora Sanchez, Lupita, remember? Me deja, will you let me, you know, pay my bill when the strawberry season comes because I don't have any money? And I would say, yeah, I will. They always came back to pay because medical care for their children is so important. Yeah, and so with that, I pass it on to Hector with his little slides.
With my little slides.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. Yeah, there's a lot of difference between back then and today. Mm-hmm. It's bigger now. The problems are bigger. They're multiplied by thousands in some of our cases because we're still having the same issues that we did back then in the 70s. Even within our own organizations that we help create and develop, exactly. They're having issues assimilating and they sort of lost the target. And we need to get that target back. And that's one of the things that I don't know if you and the audience picked up. These two people are leaving. Jose Jaime is heading off to, ¿pa dónde en Texas?
San Antonio.
He's going to become a Tejano. We'll see how he does when he comes back.
A transition for Jose.
And Vanjie's heading up to Spokane, to the cold weather, but she says she likes
it. I can handle it.
So I'm going to be missing both of them because I was an elder in training, and now with them gone, I'm now an elder, so I don't know. But a lot of things have changed, and one of the ones that I think is worth mentioning is the farm workers. Even though we've lost over 50% of our agribusiness here in Washington County is gone, the camps are pretty much gone.
Yeah.
But a lot of good reasons why. Unfortunately, the county health department says you got to upgrade those conditions or shut it down. And so they ended up shutting them down. We used to have thousands of families that would come here during the summer to harvest. Today we're talking about 400 or 500 families at best. So things are changing, but the conditions are still the same. The only farm workers, field workers, nationwide, are exempt from the National Labor Relations Act. That's the one that you and I can are afforded protection rights to act in concert to form a union for the purpose of negotiating terms and conditions of employment. Field workers are exempt from that. They can't do that, except for the state of California. And that's where Cesar Chavez came in and was able to take the National Labor Relations Act, change the name to Agricultural Labor Relations Act, but need a lot of political clout to make that happen at the legislature to pass it. I did 15 years in education and then 15 years in private industry and human resource management, and fell in love with labor relations, HR, all that stuff. One of the ones that I ran into was United Farm Workers Union, of course, but the other one was Senator L.B. Day here in Oregon. He was the Secretary Treasurer for Teamsters, and he's the one that I really mentored me in the whole process. Although he was on the other side, I was representing management, and obviously I already knew labor, so I didn't need that. So I went to go learn to see what management was up to. The Oregon Historical Society published that little document. If you can Google it, it's a PDF file. And it tells more about the stories that we finished talking about. Banji and I are featured in that story along with Annie Hernandez. What we did with Cesar Chavez is negotiate about 30 years worth of labor contracts. I represented farmers, growers, management with full financial authorization to enter into collective bargaining agreements. And so I did that with Cesar Chavez, Dolores Huerta, and many other unions, Teamsters, United Fresh Fruit and Vegetable Workers Union, the Butchers Union, Longshoremen, on and on and on, that affected Latinos in the state of California. And those contracts all had paid time off, vacations, holidays, medical, dental, vision. Some of them had 401ks, pension, merit increases, grievance procedures, arbitrations, things that don't exist and aren't afforded to farm workers right now here in the state of Oregon. We need to pass an Agricultural Labor Relations Act in order to change those conditions. Even though we've lost a lot of farm work, agribusiness, they've gone off to other service industries, hotels, construction, and the like, and now they can afford unionization, so that makes it nice. That's it for my slides. Mándeme. Dije ya.
Okay.
Ya me quieren callar.
Sí, cómo no. All right, so can we give our panel a happy birthday? Thank you. So we have about 15 minutes left, and this is our Q&A session. So when you ask your question, I'll repeat it. So the question has to do with active enforcement of folks who are here with regard to their status as either U.S. citizens or green card holders, I presume, and how that impacting folks with regard to their status, with regard to their feeling that they can actually live here safely.
I think that our Hispanic community has been living in fear since this new administration started 2 years ago, a fear that had not been present before. And the fear is based on the fact that a lot of criminal activities are coming from ICE. Mm-hmm. Separating children from their parents is a crime. There is no way that you can soften this plight of our people. What I can see is that there is something good. For example, the fact that Hillsborough is a sanctuary city. We don't have that much fear, although we still do have fear. The fact that and a police officer is here. Sorry to mention it, but the fact that we are not afraid of the police partaking on the crimes of ICE in our city is a blessing. The fact that the state of Oregon is a sanctuary state is also a big kind of relief for our Hispanic community. What else can the community at large do for all the minorities, not just Hispanic minorities, but all the minorities, is we need to be aligned with each other and fight together. Definitely, one of the little things that we are doing is marching on Monday mornings from 9 to 10 in front of the courthouse against the crimes of ICE. Help us out. We need more than 10, 12 people a week. We need 100 people a week. Mm-hmm. Pass the word around. Help us be our allies.
Any other responses to the question?
I'll surely mention something. In the 70s, 78, 79, ICE used to come into the area. But they, there was only the single men up in Glenn Walters' nursery that lived in the barn that were affected. They were always getting hauled off. We had someone in immigration that would tip us off that they were coming. This kind of sticky. So they would let us know, a group of us, that's why I said I'm always in the community, but not like these guys politically, that would let us know that ICE was coming, and I would show up, and they would give me their wallets to keep for them. Because they knew they were coming back. It was a lot easier for them to come back to the jobs that they left here. And some of them did have families, and so that was very important. But it has happened before. ICE has hit us before. But now there's families, you know, with those men, and that makes it a lot sadder because, yes, they do live in fear. You go to a store and you know, some of the people, you can hear them talking out loud, you know, about what's going on in the community, and that's sad. There is a fear that I just, it's terrible to be, you know, around people that are, I have families that I work very closely with, you know, at the food bank, and they talk about it all the time. You know, we don't know if they're gonna, you know, I'm so afraid to get a ticket because, oh my God, they could haul me off or they could haul my husband off and then we're gonna be left here. How are we gonna survive? Even if one of them is legal, how are the rest gonna survive? Because they might get, you know, deported. So there is a real fear, Dr. Yeah, about what's going on right now. And Jose, like Jose said, we all need to work together to help. I know that when I've marched with them several times, but when we march, I know that even when they see us marching, they will ask us questions, you know, is ICE in there, you know, or whatever. And we can't really get involved, but, you know, that's the best way to get involved, that there's a power in numbers, and that's what we need. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Bruce, for the question. And I really am older than they are. No. Been around for a long time and have seen these changes come and go, as Vanja just alluded to. But we always manage to be victorious at the other end. And there are several reasons for that. One is the Constitution of the United States does not preempt us to be covered under the Constitution based on our citizenship. Neither does the Declaration of Independence. Those are God-given, unalienable rights that nobody can take away. So the law's on our side in that sense. I don't know if you guys noticed when I showed you where I was from, the map was a little bit different of the United States. We are the indigenous people to the Americas. And the European Americans, or the immigrants that settled here. So we always seem to come back to that. When the United States needs help, they always send for us. The last one was the Braceros. Come and work, help us finish the railroads because the men are out fighting. What a bad time to bring Latinos here. Men are out fighting the war and they send for Mexicanos to come. Okay, fine. I never understood that, but at any rate. Something is different, Bruce. Something is really different this time around. And the big threat comes, as Jose mentioned, from this administration at the highest level. That is actually spreading this venom against Mexicanos. He wants this wall. He does not want to see a Mexicano pintado en una pared. And he just wants to get rid of us. He doesn't want NAFTA. He doesn't want that trade, which is what's bringing the undocumented here. And that affects all of us. I'm a U.S. citizen, but it still has that rippling effect of bigotry and not wanted, strangers in our own land kind of thing. I'm hoping that we're going to get some things turned around. We got a couple of things happen here in Oregon. One is the DMV issue that I hope is going to be on the ballot again, and we can take a look at that again as it relates to particularly our sanctuary status in the state that Jose referred to, because those are taking state resources, personnel, labor, and equipment and facilities for the purpose of enforcing legal status. And so I'm hoping that we can do something about that. The bottom line is that we need to get civically engaged. Jose Jaime was soliciting you to come join us, not just to march, but to get civically engaged, electing your officials, get involved in your elections, who you're voting. We have a Latino who's running for the board here with PCC. We have a Latina running at City of Hillsborough for school district. We have three new members that are really look great. Get involved in those elections and get the right people elected that are going to help us. They're going to be our allies at the place where policy is made and allocation of resources. So each of us that I look at, that I recognize that are out there in the audience, are civic engaged people and allies. And you need to step it up to that next level of governance. If we're not involved at the governance level making policies, the board of visitors getting involved with our administrators, we're going to be having the same conversation 10 years from now. Mm-hmm. So, Bruce, the answer to your question is step it up. step it up, and get engaged, get involved.
Okay. Next question, Dick. Yeah, well, so the question is, what do you recommend for the young people who are here?
Learn. Learn what's going on. Your world is not your family only. Look around. Be participant. And especially get interested in not only thinking about your own benefit or your family's benefit, look into wider areas, your community. Like our founding families of Centro Cultural, they didn't look after themselves only. They looked after themselves to help all the group.
Continue your education. That was so important. I think that that's what set me going, was that at least I knew that I had a high school graduation, you know, a certificate. And I said, well, that can open the door for me. Now it takes more than that. So you need to continue your education. Yeah, get involved. Yeah.
Education. Best example, and be a role model in our community. We have such a deficit in bilingual, bicultural teachers. In the county, in the state, at the national level.
Social workers, yeah.
Social workers, counselors. Law enforcement, navigating our way as an advocate, community involvement. Continue your education and be a role model.
Especially in mental health counseling, because when I investigated child abuse cases, I also got trained to do therapy. And through the state, because we didn't have the resources to provide the families with the, you know, what they had to comply with in order to get out of the system. And I've also, like I said, done, I trained the community about child abuse and sexual abuse, and because once you get into the system, you're not getting out. And it is generational. So we need to stop it somewhere. Yeah, education, you know, social workers, mental health especially, counselors. But counselors that can deal with maybe, I'm going to say something kind of, I guess, sensitive. Mexicanos con Mexicanos, because even though we get thrown into the group of Hispanics, part of our cultures are very different. We think differently many times, you know, and we grow up differently, even though we are Hispanic, so. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah. But that, you know, it's cultural as well. Mm-hmm. We resolve conflict resolution in a different way than someone who's white, male, privileged. Mm-hmm. Very different. Very different styles and very different outcomes usually. So,
this is a great opportunity for us to learn more about the history of Latinos and Tejanos in Washington County. And I know we've all learned something, or more than just one thing, about this history. And I think it's important to continue this conversation to enable us to learn from you, our elders, who really have done so much to help not just the Latino Tejano communities in Washington County, but just help people in general better understand our population.